Well, good afternoon. Welcome to CROWD Church. So it's great to have you back. How are we doing this sunny afternoon?
Great to be here. I'm doing really well. Hi, everyone. Lovely to see you this afternoon. Welcome along to CROWD Church. It's great to have you with us.
Yeah, absolutely. I was out a minute ago walking around the local park. The sun was shining. It was beautiful. And now I'm looking at the crowds and it's about to open and pour down.
I think so. I think it's time to come in and join CROWD Church. Now you've had your sun for today, so why not come in, let it rain outside, and then just join in with us.
That would be absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, you've managed to enjoy some sun today. It's been long overdue, hasn't it, Matt? We've been desperate for a little bit of sunshine in Britain. If you're not in Britain, I hope you're enjoying the sunshine somewhere else.
Yeah, we welcome to the here, crazy weather of England. Yeah, the crazy, crazy weather which we have. But
welcome to CROWD. Also, if you're not British...
Yeah, go on.
I was just going to say, Matt, if you're not British, then it's absolutely true. The stereotype that all we like to talk about is the weather is 100% true.
Yes, absolutely. And we like to do that drinking tea. Sal, what are you drinking right now?
It's tea. I promise, Matt, it's tea.
Brilliant. Brilliant. So we are quintessentially English. There's no doubt about it. But we are an international, you know, digital church. For those of you who don't know, CROWD is a digital church. We're an online church. And we're going to spend the next 45 minutes to an hour just having fun and learning about all things Christianity. Yes, we are. We're going to get into a whole bunch of stuff today. Absolutely. Do you know what's coming up, Sal?
I do know what's coming up today. Amazing Sharon. Yeah. Sharon Emerson is doing the talk today. Fabulous. Now that's we've got up to the part in Mark, which is about the resurrection of Jesus. And she's going to be looking into that and the evidence that we have for the truth of the resurrection. So that's going to be worth sticking around for. And then after some worship a bit later on, me and Matt will be back to discuss your questions from Sharon's talk. So it's well worth coming back for that, isn't it, Matt?
Absolutely. It's my favourite part. I mean, you know, my wife's going to be great. There's no doubt about it. But genuinely, my favourite part of CROWD is always the conversation street, the bit, you know, the conversations afterwards. It's great fun. So definitely stick around for that. And Sal, listen, have you been practising?
Oh, no, don't do it to me. I forgot to practice. I've had so much time. I could have been practicing. Right. OK,
yeah, you could have.
Hang on. Let me just. Right. OK.
First time. No. Yes. There you go.
Yay!
Well done.
So let me just do this. Yeah. My camera's a little bit out of focus. There we go.
I thought you were just covering your shame for a minute.
Yeah, that too. It's embarrassing. It's really embarrassing. Thanks, Matt, for doing that. I feel welcome back. Thank you so much
welcome.
For that.
Welcome. You know what? Whilst you're away, Rach Marshall, a couple of weeks ago, she was hosting with us. And... Same trouble, Sal. So, you know, it's not just your good self.
I'm not alone every week.
I do like to have a bit of fun with that. If you don't know what I'm talking about, if this is your first time here, all I try and do is get Sal basically to point to the number at the bottom of the screen. And we just struggle with that every week.
Thanks, Matt. You really made me sound like a little bit of an idiot right there. This is Matt trying to get his own back for, you know, some of the digs that I might make during our time together. So, you know, Matt likes to get in there nice and early with the Sally can't point at anything kind
of
dig.
That's okay.
It's all good fun. And we hope that you feel a real part of the team and welcome with us today. This is a church for people who maybe don't see the point of church or want to find out a little bit more. And that's what we're here for. We want to hear from you, want to hear your questions, want to hear your comments. So do get involved.
Yeah, do. And also, we like to have a bit of a laugh along the way. You may have noticed that as well. We do like to have a bit of fun. And so there is no doubt Sal's going to get her own back as we go through.
Just bide my time. There's always an opportunity.
Do you want to tell people why there's a phone number on the bottom of the screen?
I do, because if you don't want to put your comments in the comment section, but you still want to get involved, then you can get in contact with us via our WhatsApp number. Or maybe you'd like us to pray about something. We do believe in the power of prayer. So if you would like us to pray for you, you don't have to be a Christian. You don't have to believe, but we will pray for you. So if you want that, then do get in contact with us via that number. That's why it's so important, even if I can't
point to it.
Yeah. Matt Drew, hello Matt, helpfully in the comments it says, I've got worse. Yes, I think I have. But, you know, I've been unwell. So, you know, just a little bit of sympathy, a little bit of sympathy.
I'm being very sympathetic. I'm being very sympathetic.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. It's none but love for you. Right, so.
Oh, dear.
Yeah, yeah, it's going to be one of them. So I'm looking forward to this one because, like you said, Sharon, my beautiful wife, is doing the talk today all about the resurrection. Now, we have been meandering is probably the right word to use to describe our journey through Mark's gospel. We have been meandering away through Mark's gospel, which is a book in the Bible which chronicles the life of Christ. If you're not familiar with the New Testament, you've got four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. And we decided that we would go through one of them, which is Mark's gospel, just looking at the life of Jesus. Obviously a very central figure to the Christian faith. And so we are... do you know what, Sal? We are almost at the end of our journey through Mark's gospel.
We are. And, you know, there's been so much to get out of this one book of the Bible. We've been able to get so many different talks and topics and different things have come out of it. It's been incredible. It made me laugh, actually, when Will Sopwith was doing, I think it was last week, wasn't it, Will? Yeah. He was brilliant, by the way. You can always go back and watch any of the talks on our website. But he was fabulous last week. And it made me kind of just smile to myself a little bit when he said, you know, Mark, it's one of the small books of the Bible. And I was thinking, yeah, small book. We've been doing it for over a year. We've been going through it.
We really have. There's so much good stuff in there.
So, yeah, we've got a couple more weeks on Mark and then we'll be moving on to something new and exciting.
Absolutely. So, and we'll let you know what that's going to be very, very shortly. In the meantime, without further ado, let's get the good lady Sharon on to talk about the resurrection. Fasten your seatbelts because this one's going to be fun.
And good afternoon to you all. I did the talk at CROWD a few weeks ago on the passage where Jesus was in the garden praying just before his crucifixion. I said that there are many reasons why people choose not to follow Jesus today, and that one of those reasons is the very valid question over whether or not it's all true. I mean, it all sounds a bit far-fetched, doesn't it? Surely it's not possible for someone to come back to life after they've been dead a few days. It goes against the laws of nature. The problem is, the Christian faith is all centred around the death and resurrection of Jesus. And if that didn't really happen, then our faith is nothing more than a fairy tale, and everyone else should pity us. Even the Bible agrees on that, as this verse says. And if Christ is not alive, you are still lost in your sins, and your faith is a fantasy. It would also mean that those believers in Christ who've passed away have simply perished. If the only benefit of our hope in Christ is limited to this life on earth, we deserve to be pitied more than all others. But if it is true that Jesus is who he says he is, and he did in fact rise from the dead, then that has implications for everyone. There's so much that could actually be said that I'll only really scratch the surface, but my main aim is to get you interested to start investigating for yourself. I'm going to look at three common objections or alternative explanations to the resurrection account and give you some answers to those. First, though, I want to look at a phrase you've probably heard, and that is the phrase blind faith. It's a term often used to say that religious faith is faith without evidence, or worse, in spite of evidence to the contrary. The atheist Richard Dawkins calls faith a delusion, and describes it as a persistent false belief held in the face of strong contradictory evidence. Christianity, however, does not require blind faith. It's a faith based on the evidence of real events in the past, as well as many other types of faith, that give us confidence in God, his character, and his word for the future. Jesus said, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind." loving God involves using our brain, not switching it off. During a trip to a place called Capernaum, Jesus came across a man who was paralyzed. Jesus said to that man that he forgave him for all the stuff that he'd done. And one of the religious people remarked that that was blasphemy. I mean, who can forgive that sort of thing except for God himself? What was Jesus' response? He said, "Why do you entertain evil thoughts in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the paralyzed man, "Get up, take your mat and go home." Then the man got up and went home. Jesus gave evidence for his claims. The book of Luke was written by Luke to a man called Theophilus to show him the evidence so that he could believe. Here's what Luke wrote as his introduction. "Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty of the things you've been taught." So our faith for God in the future is partly based on evidence that he has given us from the past. To give a more personal example, if my lovely hubby Matt says to me that he'll buy me an expensive present for my birthday, I have confidence that he'll do that, even though I can't see the present yet. And I have confidence because of my knowledge of him as a person, my past experience of his generosity, and the fact that he's really good at spending money. Even if we currently didn't have any money, and so our circumstances made that promise look impossible, I'd still have confidence that somehow he'd be able to pull off his promise without robbing a bank or going into debt, because I know him. I can trust what he says because of the past evidence of his character. And it's the same is true with God. Our faith is not blind, but is based on evidence from science, from history, from the testimonies of others, from personal experience and many other things. I'm a Christian because I found him to be trustworthy. So, with that as our starting point, let's look at today's passage as it builds on what Will talked about last week. If you weren't with us last week, Will talked about the burial of Jesus and how he was placed in a tomb with a large stone placed at the entrance. As I read, imagine that your friend has just died and you're going to their grave to lay flowers. What would your expectations be? The passage says, "Now, when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they said among themselves, 'Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us?' But when they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, 'Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He's risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he's going before you into Galilee. There you'll see him, as he said to you.' So they went out quickly and fled from the tomb, for they trembled and were amazed. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now when he rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he'd cast seven demons. She went and told those who'd been with him, as they mourned and wept. And when they heard that he was alive and had been seen by her, they did not believe. After that, he appeared in another form to two of them, and they walked and went into the country. And they went and told it to the rest, but they did not believe them either." It's no wonder the women were alarmed. How would you react if you turned up to your mate's grave to find it was empty and instead there were a couple of angels there? I'd be pretty alarmed too. Okay, so let's jump into some of the objections that people have to this story. Will touched on one of them last week, which was maybe Jesus didn't really die. If you haven't already heard Will's talk, you'll find it on our website, which is www.crowd.church, or on our YouTube channel. It's a great talk and worth listening to. I don't have time to look up all of the objections to the resurrection, as we try to keep these talks short. So I'm going to briefly cover these three. So objection one. We can't trust the gospel accounts of the resurrection because they all say contradictory things. Objection two. Miracles like the resurrection just aren't possible, are they? And objection three. What if the tomb was empty because the body was stolen? So, objection one is we can't trust the gospel accounts of the resurrection because they all say contradictory things. If you're not familiar with the Bible, it's a book that's made up of 66 books. Of those, four of them, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, are known as the four gospels, and they claim to contain eyewitness accounts of the life, death and resurrection of Jesus. The problem is, the accounts are all slightly different. Here are some examples from Dr. Bart Ehrman, who used to be a Christian but now is an agnostic.
What day did Jesus die on? That's a simple question. And luckily, we're told in both Mark and John. In Mark's gospel, we're told that Jesus died the day after the Passover meal was eaten in Jerusalem. John tells us explicitly, chapter 19, verse 14, that Jesus died the day before the Passover meal was eaten, on the day of preparation for the Passover. That's different. He couldn't die both days. What about the time? According to Mark, he died at 9 in the morning. According to John, he wasn't condemned to death until afternoon, John 19, 14. These are accounts that differ from one another.
So if the eyewitness accounts all say different things, can we actually trust them? Do they actually say different things? Do the differences really contradict each other, or do they just look like they do? Do the differences undermine the main message of the passages? So let's pick one of them and investigate. Let's look at the contradiction in the number of women who went to the tomb. The passage we read from Mark's Gospel mentions three women who went to the tomb: Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, Mary the mother of James, and Salome. Matthew's Gospel said that Mary Magdalene went with the other Mary, that's two women. Luke's Gospel said it was the women who'd come with Jesus from Galilee and certain other women who went to the tomb. That's a group of women of unknown number. A bit later on in Luke, it says that the women were Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and other women. John's Gospel, verse 1, says this. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So he only mentions one woman, Mary Magdalene. But if you read the next verse, it says this. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter, and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they've laid him." Who's the "we" she's talking about in John's narrative? So John's narrative doesn't exclude other women being involved. In fact, it suggests that there were more than one, but it just focuses on one of them by name and what she said. You see, as we dig a bit deeper, we see that different accounts actually clarify their apparent contradictions. There's a guy called J. Warner Wallace, who's a cold case homicide detective. He used to be an atheist, but after investigating the Gospels using the same skills he uses as a cold case detective, he became a Christian and wrote a book about his process, which he called Cold Case Christianity. This is what he has to say about the differences in the accounts of how many women went to the tomb.
So what we have here is really the question, not a question about how many were there, and there's some difference between how many were there based on the account. Instead, there's a question about who gets highlighted in each account. That's really the only difference in accounts, is why would this gospel author choose to highlight this one but not another? And that's really where we want to kind of, and this is, this is so common to eyewitness accounts that I work in homicides. unless you're going to stop them and say, okay, time out. I noticed you said so-and-so, but you didn't mention these other, were they not there? Oh, no, they were there too, but you know, okay. If I don't stop and make each person specifically give me the rich kind of unmentioned detail that I know is missing because I've already talked to somebody else about this. Well, this is not what's happening in the Gospels. There's no detective interviewer who's making sure that this is an exhaustive list or this is an exhaustive account. That's an important principle, by the way, folks. When you look at these accounts, you sometimes look at them, and I, as a detective, I'm also examining these as eyewitness accounts, right? But remember, there's no eyewitness interviewer. And without the interviewer who typically asks you to empty out everything you saw, you're only going to get a partial account. I even get partial accounts when there is an eyewitness interviewer who is asking you to empty out everything. So don't be surprised that we're going to get something that's slightly a small variation in it when you don't have an investigative interviewer who's asking you to go further.
The differences don't mean that the accounts are not true. It just means the writers have highlighted different women depending on their focus and what the focus of their writing is. In fact, if all witnesses say exactly the same thing, you tend to think that they'd just come up with the story and have rehearsed it together. There are other valid reasons for the differences too, but we won't go into all of those right now. So we'll move on to objection two. Objection two says miracles aren't possible. Now, Google defines a miracle as an extraordinary and welcome event that's not explicable by natural or scientific laws and is therefore attributed to a divine agency. Many dismiss miracles because they're committed to a naturalistic explanation for everything. Here's what Richard, Lewontin, a biologist and geneticist, has to say about this idea. It's not that the methods and institutions of science somehow compel us to accept a material explanation of the phenomenal world, but on the contrary, that we are forced by our a priori adherence to material causes to create an apparatus of investigation and a set of concepts that produce material explanations, no matter how counterintuitive, no matter how mystifying to the uninitiated. Moreover, that materialism is absolute, for we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. Historians too can reject claims of miracles, not because miracles are not possible or haven't been seen, but because they're committed to explaining everything by natural causes. Some have made the claim that because we can explain many things by science, it proves that God doesn't exist. But as John Lennox, who was a professor of maths at Oxford University, explains, there are different levels of explanation. He takes the example of a kettle boiling and asks, why is the kettle boiling? You could say that it's boiling because a large electric current flows into the heating element of the kettle. The element's resistance turns the electrical energy into heat, which passes to the water. The reason John Lennox says the kettle is actually boiling is because he wants a cup of tea. Now, these are two very different explanations, but just because they're different doesn't mean they actually conflict with each other. They explain things on different levels, one on a natural level and the other on a personal level. If nature is all there is, the miracles are not possible by that definition. The definition that I gave before. But if the God of the Bible does actually exist, then miracles are not really that big a deal. I mean, would it really be that hard for the God who created the whole universe and everything in it to interact with what he's made to heal somebody's body or to raise someone from the dead? I don't think so. So why don't we see miracles all the time? There are probably loads of reasons, but here is one that Pete Gregg mentions in his book, How to Pray. The laws of science are explanations of the ways in which God mostly chooses to act, but sometimes he exercises his right to go off-piste. When Jesus turned water into wine, he broke the laws of chemistry. When he walked on water, he defied the law of gravity. He even broke the second law of thermodynamics by rising from the dead. C.S. Lewis says, but God can and does on occasion modify the behaviour of matter and produce what we call miracles is part of the Christian faith. Before he adds, but the very conception of a common and therefore stable world demands that these occasions should be extremely rare. God can and does work through miracles, but not all his work involves miracles. So on to objection three, the body was stolen. Some have said that Jesus' body was stolen by either the disciples or the authorities. Now, it doesn't make sense for the disciples to have taken the body because they nearly all went on to be killed for their faith. Many people are prepared to die for their beliefs, but it's not common to die for something you know isn't true. The martyrs would often die in horrific ways, and so would, under duress, have admitted that they'd really stolen the body and made up the story. And think about Peter. Tradition records that he was crucified for his faith, but he felt it was appropriate to be crucified upside down, and from that position he gave his final speech. Why would he do that if he was complicit in stealing the body of Christ? But could the authorities have stolen it? Well, one of the main strategies the early believers had of sharing their faith was to talk about the resurrection of Jesus. And as far as the authorities go, if they'd stolen the body, it would have been to their advantage to like produce the body to stop the rumours about Jesus rising from the dead. So what does all this mean? We can debate the authority of the Gospels as eyewitness accounts. We can debate about miracles, and we can look at the idea that Jesus' body was stolen. I believe that answering these objections, I actually find evidence for the resurrection. And to be honest, I've barely scratched the surface. In jury trials, the evidence is laid out, witnesses are cross-examined, and then the prosecution and the defence make their case using the same evidence. The jury then consider the evidence to decide which interpretation best fits beyond reasonable doubt, not beyond all doubt. Regarding faith, I think there will always be unanswered questions and things that we don't know. And I find that when I start studying any subject, the more I get into it, the more there seems to know and the more complex things get. But we're a bit like that jury, looking at the evidence and the opposing arguments and trying to work out what is the truth. For me, the evidence points beyond a reasonable doubt to the resurrection. And when I look at both sides of the argument, and my faith is strengthened as a result. So, if you're a follower of Jesus already, I encourage you to investigate this more for yourself so that you can give multiple reasons for your faith. And if you're not a follower of Jesus, I encourage you to investigate this more yourself and search for the truth. This is good news that is too good to miss out on if it is true, that there is a God who's created us for a purpose, that he loves us enough to come down to our level and to suffer so that we can be forgiven and have a relationship with him, with our Father God. It's not necessarily an easy path to take. It means giving up our own way of living, and it involves suffering and sacrifice, so it can do, but it's worth it. Now, I usually like to leave you with a quote. So today's quote is from the writer and theologian C.S. Lewis. He says, "Christianity is a statement which, if false, is of no importance. And if true, is of infinite importance. The one thing it cannot be is moderately important."
Wow. Thanks, Sharon. What an amazing quote to finish on as well. I think we need to come back to that and have a little think through that whilst we go into a time of worship in just a minute. We would love you to get involved now. We would love you to put your thoughts and comments down. And what would you like us to discuss in Conversation Street? What particularly came out for you in that talk that Sharon's just done there? I think there's loads that we could discuss. So put down your thoughts and ideas and the things that you would like Matt and myself to talk about. We're going to go into a time of worship. We're going to have this amazing song now. It's called Your Love is Amazing. And it's all about the love of God, the incredible love of God that he has for you. That's whether you believe or not, he still has that amazing love for you. There's a brilliant line in it that says, "When I am surrounded, your love carries me." So maybe that's something for you today. Maybe you feel like you're surrounded. The love of God is for you as well. So we're just gonna listen to this song. You can sing along if you know it, or just let the words kind of speak to you as you read them. Put your comments in, and Matt and I will be back shortly afterwards.
Your love amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain from beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Your love is surprising, I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. Every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Gently lift me when I am surrounded. Your love carries me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing.
Very good. Very good. Love that song. Love Dan Pryor's voice. Thanks, Dan. Absolutely. Well, Sal, what did you think to that talk?
Wow. Loads to kind of think about, really, isn't there? I think, you know, there have been lots of people in the past who've sort of said to me, oh, I can't believe all that. I can't believe that Jesus rose from the dead. And I've never been able to kind of go, well, here's the sort of good stuff that you can kind of say in reply. So that's really helpful, those kind of 3 points of the most common arguments against it, and then, you know, the counter arguments, really. So really helpful. Thanks, Sharon. Really good.
Yeah, no, it's great. I like I love the analogy, right, that it's a bit like being in a court of law and you're the jury, and the evidence is presented by both the prosecution and the defense, right? Those for the resurrection, those against the resurrection. So John Lennox, who is for, who's the maths professor from Oxford, the kettle analogy was from John, versus, say, Richard Dawkins. And they have these debates, and they take the evidence, and they both interpreted it in quite different ways. But that's what jurors do, isn't it? And so you're presented with the evidence, and you kind of have to make a decision for yourself. And I love that. I really love that. So I think it's a great analogy.
I love that. Yeah, me too. I'm a massive fan of a courtroom drama. Oh, I love love that. A Few Good Men. It's one of my, you can't handle the truth. You know, it's one of my all-time favorite films. And I think it's, you know, it's really good to question these things, to not just kind of accept what you're told and just go, oh, okay, then someone I trust has told me that, therefore, you know, that's it. I'm not going to kind of question it or find out for myself. I think it's really important. God can handle that. He doesn't mind us questioning these things. He wants us to look into these things more deeply. And I think that that's, you know, that's really what we should be doing, not just accepting everything that we're told, but questioning things. But also, for me, it was that sort of, you know, that kind of balance between proof and faith. You know, you've got to have both. You can't have one without the other. And there is an element of faith involved here. And you have to get to that point as well, where you've got the evidence, but your faith takes you that final step, doesn't it, to actually believe.
Yeah.
So I think that's really important.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, we get a lot of emails and messages from you good folks during the week. A lot of people questioning, you know, the faith and hasn't, you know, is there any proof? Is there any evidence? And quite often the first thing I'll say to people is exactly what Sharon said at the start of the talk. Go and look at the resurrection, right? Because if there's no resurrection, there's no Christian faith. And if there is a resurrection, I can't even say it. If there is a resurrection, there is definitely something that you need to think about. And so that, I think, is a really, really great starting point. You know, look at the resurrection. And Sharon, as she said, has just literally scratched the surface of it.
Yeah.
That book, actually, you know, the guy, J. Warner Wallace, the American guy that was talking during her talk.
Yeah.
That book, Cold Case Christianity. It's a bit like, I don't know if you've ever read the book, The Case for Christ. Have you come across that one by Lee Strobel?
No.
If you like a good courtroom drama, get The Case for Christ. That's all I'm saying.
Okay.
So this is, I think Lee Strobel was a lawyer, an atheist lawyer looking to disprove the resurrection, looks at the evidence, becomes a Christian. J. Warner Wallace, he was an atheist. And I think his partner had become a Christian. Somebody in his family had become a Christian. And he's a homicide murder detective, right? He investigates for a living murders.
Mm.
And so he was like, I'm going to use everything I know about detectivism. That's the wrong word, but you know what I mean.
We'll go with it.
And I'm going to disprove Christianity. And he ended up becoming a Christian. And they've both written these books looking at the evidence of these kind of things. And they're definitely worth reading.
Just say the names of the two books again, Matt.
So J. Warner Wallace, Cold Case Christianity, and then Lee Strobel, A Case for Christ. It is a proper meaty. And there's another one called Evidence Demands a Verdict, if you really want to get into it as well. I mean, just three outstanding books. Really helped me in my early Christian faith to go, yes, okay, this was very helpful.
Yeah, I think especially if you are somebody who, you know, perhaps you're very scientific minded, or you know, you really want those answers and the evidence. I think these things are really, really helpful, as long as we sort of understand that they go hand in hand with faith as well. We can't possibly, you know, we can't talk you round into believing. Someone said this, someone very wise actually said this to me a long time. It's not our responsibility to convince you that this is true. You know, we can tell you, we can kind of go through the Bible, we can talk about these things, but actually that's your choice then, that's your decision. Mm-hmm. As to whether or not you're going to take that final step. I loved that quote that Sharon ended with. It was a bit of I was sort of like a rabbit in the headlights a little bit, because she said that amazing quote and then it was me.
There you go.
I wanted just to kind of, there it is again. I wanted us to just kind of bring that up again and just have a little think about this. So let's just read it again. Christianity is a statement which, if false, is of no importance, and if true, is of infinite importance, and the one thing it cannot be is moderately important. That's an amazing quote, isn't it? And so it's worth finding out, isn't it, whether we believe it's true or not.
Yeah, absolutely. It's definitely, like you say, put in the time in. Have you ever been asked, right, Sal, a question by someone and you've not known how to answer it, And it's kind of made you feel a little bit unsure about your faith.
Yeah, I thought, any question? Well, I'm a teacher, so yeah, that's a daily basis. You know, miss, why? Why is the sky blue? Why is this?
Yeah.
So on a regular basis, yeah. Alexa, amazing, but not for everything. Of course, there are so many questions that I don't know the answer to, and have made me kind of go, or when you hear people say those things, you think, oh, actually, you know, have I just blindly believed without actually having a really good foundation? But the faith part of it for me has been, I've seen the truth of it in my life and the life of those close around me. I want to understand and know more about the theology of it, but the faith for me is kind of proved itself, and those other things kind of come afterwards. But that's how I work, and I know that not everybody works in the same way as me. No, I expect, Matt, that you wanted a lot more proof, did you, Matt?
Yeah, I wanted, I like books like Cold Case Christianity. I like books like, you know, Evidence Demands a Verdict, because it's very, it's good for me to think those kind of things through. And I come from a more sciencey background. And it's like when I'm at work, I like data. Do you know what I mean? And I like to look at the hard data, and I like to run things through numbers and understand stuff like that. Mm. But I've just read, it's not a Christian book at all. I've read a book recently called Alchemy, right? And this was, I can't remember the guy's name, actually, Jonathan somebody or other, from Ogilvy, and they were a marketing agency, or they are a marketing agency, one of the biggest marketing agencies in the world. And his whole thing in the book was, yes, data exists, but sometimes you just need a little bit of alchemy. Do you know what I mean? A little bit of that kind of magic, and a little bit of that kind of faith. And I really, really like that. Sometimes you just need a little bit of alchemy. And I think it's very true. I think it's very, very true. I can look at the data. I can look at the numbers in work, in Christianity. I can look at the evidence. But like you say, sometimes you just need that faith, that little bit of alchemy that says it's not just about all the data, but the data is helpful, if that makes sense.
Yes, it is. Yeah, definitely. I think the two go hand in hand, very much so. There's a lot of, I'm just looking at the comments here, and there's a lot of comments about speeding. If you're not quite sure what that's referring to,
I want you to know this has not come from me.
No, that's helpfully another Matt. Thank you, Matt, who's referring to a talk that I did a while ago about justice. And I did mention, slightly regretting it now, that I'd kind of gone on a speed awareness course. I like his question, Miss, why have you been banned from driving? I haven't been banned from driving. I went on a speed awareness course, that was all. I'm very good now. I've learned my lesson.
I tell you what, Sal, right? I don't know if they taught you this at teaching school. Surely if you just ignore that comment, eventually Matt will just stop.
I know, but it's kind of funny, isn't it?
So, okay.
I don't mind. I don't mind. If you give it, you've got to be able to take it as well, haven't
That's
you?
True, apparently.
So it's really important. Whilst we are on important matters, can we just have a little look at that photo again, please?
I knew you were going to ask this.
Can you magically make that appear?
I can. Just give me 1 second and I will.
Because we cannot let this go by. A brilliant talk from Sharon. I love the little kind of, you know, analogy of Matt giving her a present at the beginning. But can we just look at this photo again?
It's not, honestly, Sally, it's not coming on. I don't know why. Hang on a second.
Oh, Matt.
Hang on. Hang on.
Come on. You can make it happen.
I'm just going to make this work. You there we go. Keep everybody entertained for a little while, and then I'll be with you directly.
Okay. What I wonder is what do we think that Matt had this photo taken for? You know, what was the purpose of this particular pose? Is it a catalogue shoot? I mean, what is he actually doing? Is he trying to be like down with the kids, or what is Matt? What were you thinking? What's going on? Tell us. Talk us through this picture.
So what happened was. This is a really boring story, but what happened was we did a photo shoot at work, so every member of the staff had to get their photos taken. And you know what it's like? Some people in front of the camera are quite stiff and rigid. And so I was just clowning around to try and, you know, get everybody a bit more at ease with themselves. Okay. And the fabulous Lindy Rogers, you know Lindy?
I do know Lindy.
Yeah, yeah. So Lindy was taking these photos, and that was one she decided to keep and send to me.
Okay, well, have you got like a 6-foot picture of that in your house? Now I can just imagine that there's some kind of like, you know, you walk into Matt's house and there is a life-size picture of Matt.
Well, yeah. I tell you, I know what you're getting for Christmas now, so.
Oh, wow. Could you engrave it in wood or something? That would be amazing. That sounds
yeah,
like
yeah, just so you can use it as a bow and arrow target at the end of the garden, right?
Brilliant.
Put it on your dartboard. Brilliant. Right.
Love it.
Yeah, now back to the comments here. Nicholas said, someone I know once said once, the resurrection has to be true. If it was a lie, it would have been uncovered. The Watergate scandal lasted only 3 weeks. And Jesus' resurrection is obviously, this debate has been going on for thousands and thousands of years. I thought that was a really interesting comment, actually.
Yeah.
That actually a lot of time you figure these things out. And here we are, still 2,000 years debating it. Fascinating.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I think that all adds to the evidence of it, isn't it? If you look at, you know, these incredibly intelligent people, scientists and detectives and, you know, all sorts of people who believe this to be true, mm-hmm. you know, I'm happy to go along with that. And as I said, for me, it's, you know, it's about the actual reality of it that I've seen in my life and the lives of people that I know, and how, you know, having Jesus in their lives has made such a difference. Mm-hmm. And as Sharon said, you know, it's not easy. You still get the same difficulties in life. You still experience the same things. But having somebody to walk with you through that is incredible.
It is, and that's a really interesting point. At some point, it goes beyond looking at the evidence to experience.
Yeah.
And yes, I'm fairly sure I can hold my own in conversations about Christ on various different levels. But fundamentally, one of the things you cannot take away from me is my experience and my experiences of God and Christianity and what I've seen and what I've been involved with and what I've known to be true. And that's the fundamental point. In all of this, and that's, like you say, it's where our faith gets strengthened. Talking of faith, we're going to need some, because I've just had a notification here that Liverpool are down 1-0.
Oh gosh, right, okay, we better quickly wrap this up. Come on, there's things to do.
So Lords, throw up a quick one.
Yeah,
for Liverpool.
Do, you do know that, yeah, God is a Liverpool supporter, don't you? But anyway,
Yeah, let's not go there.
That's controversial.
Yeah, there's less evidence for that than the resurrection.
Yeah, there's zero evidence for that. sorry, yeah, very flippant. But we like to finish these sections with a different type of question. So Nicola has sent us a question this week, and it is, what's the weirdest thing a guest has done in your house?
Oh, wow.
I'm not sure where that question's going. Let me think.
I can tell you it's not really, it's funny now, it wasn't funny at the time. One of the stories I do like to tell. At the top of our house, we put in a bathroom, you know, like a toilet at the top of our house. It's a 4-story house, so going all the way downstairs to the toilet was a long way, so we put one in at the top. But to make it work, we had to put in one of those SaniFlow things, you know, the macerators,
the thing
that pumps it up and over pipes. And so there's a sign in the bathroom saying, do not put down the toilet anything that is not paper, basically, because the mass, it doesn't shred, you know, like certain items. Let's just leave it there, right? Certain items.
Yeah, we've got imagination, that's fine.
Yeah. Classic one, toilet wipes, right? You know, you use them to wipe and you throw them down. And anyway, they don't go through a macerator very well. They clog it up. No. So Anna, then Nicholson, now Catchpole, was our lodger at the time. Managed to put something down that toilet, which blocked it. I think it was some kind of wipes. And there was literally water cascading all the way down our stairs from that toilet.
Oh, wow.
All the carpet had to come up. I mean, it stank. And it was just...
I like how you named the person as well. So big up to them for you naming the person that blocked your toilet. Brilliant.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. I can't think of anything weird that someone's done in my house, but I did find out recently my nephew lived with us for a while, and it was only a couple of years after. No. I'm getting to the bit. I just found out recently what he got up to whilst he was living with us. And So he lived with us. It was all great. And then he moved out to do kind of other things. And then he was here a little while ago. And he said, how good a mood are you in, Auntie Sally? And I'm like, yeah, I am. Fine. Why? And he's like, well, just something I wanted to tell you about when I lived with you. I had a couple of parties while you were away. And then he went on to tell me about all these like taxi loads of people that had come, come into the house, and all the stuff that was going on in the house. And I
thought they were really good pies.
Oh, did you? All right, brilliant. Thanks for telling me. I was like, I had no idea. I think he'd kind of woken up probably like an hour before we were due home and managed to kind of clean all traces of everything. And I had no idea at all.
Wow. That's quite impressive, the fact that you didn't know.
I know. I mean,
hats off to him for doing that. That was
yeah, he's obviously very good at cleaning, or I'm very unobservant.
Yeah. Well, here's the weirdest thing. I am gonna say this one last story because it has come to my mind. This is the weirdest thing that's happened in my house. Okay. And it involves my wife, and it involves my eldest child.
Right.
Okay. So, and I know they're watching now going, what is he going to talk? He's going to tell the story. Yes, he is. Josh, when he was a wee young nipper, so when he was like 18 months old, something like that, 2 years old, he decided he was going to be helpful for his mum and cleaned the toilet, right? Another toilet story. Cleaned the toilet in our house with my toothbrush. Okay. Somehow got my toothbrush, cleaned the toilet bowl with it. Awesome. Sharon, right? Sharon sees this, okay, takes the toothbrush off Josh, right, and doesn't throw it away, for whatever reason puts it back in the toothbrush holder.
Okay.
So the next day I said, Sharon, I'm feeling really rough, right? And she says to me, oh, that reminds me,
oh no,
don't use your toothbrush. Yep,
that's horrible. That's
fortunately
really horrible.
Fortunately, forgiveness reigns in our house. But I do like to tell the story.
That is a good story. I like that. That is a good story.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Right, shall we move on to our catch up then, Matt?
Let's do it. Let's do it.
What everyone's been doing this week.
Yeah, let's run the catch up VT. Here we go.
Hello, everyone. My name's Elias, and welcome to Sunday Catch Up. Now, in case you're new around here, Sunday Catch Up's a little section where we talk about what you've been doing in the week. This could be anything like a walk in the park, nice meal, trip to the beach, anything you want. Personally, I had a very interesting experience of getting my hair braided, which you should see a photo of in a second. And personally, I don't think it looked good. But, you know, I'd be interested to hear what you think in the comments when you see the photo. Feel free to check that out. Now I'll hand over to everyone else. Thanks everyone for the clips. And remember, if you want to send in any clips, you can text the WhatsApp number on the screen. Hopefully it's above my head or I'm going to look quite stupid. Or you can use the hashtag CrowdCatchUp on Instagram. Thanks everyone and see you next week.
There you go.
Thanks,
I like
Elias.
The braided hair, Elias. I'm not going to lie. I thought the braided hair looked good.
Yeah, it's good. I like it. Lots of good stuff. Yeah, well done, Elias. So send in your stuff to catch up so that you can be on there and we can see what you have been up to in the week. We would love to see all your pictures.
Absolutely. And Josh, I'm curious to know why you've been writing dramatic music.
Yeah, isn't physics keeping you busy enough, Josh? Come on, they're clearly not working you hard enough if you've got time to do that.
He's got exams this week and everything. Maybe this is just his way of chilling out. I don't know. Just write some dramatic music.
Maybe.
Sharon says, there may be forgiveness, but definitely not forgetfulness. That toothbrush story has been told so many times.
Oh, it's a good one, though. Yeah, yeah, I'd be telling that to everybody I met.
Absolutely. And Matt, well done for getting your jab, dude. That was good to see.
Yes.
Have you had your first vaccine yet, Sal?
I have, yeah. I've had AstraZeneca and I'm waiting for a date for my second jab. But yeah, everyone needs to get vaccinated.
That's our public service.
Oh, did you see that flash of lightning?
I did, yeah, yeah.
Thunder and lightning here now. Whoa.
Oh, wow. I wonder when we'll hear it here. Oh, there it is. We're a few seconds behind you. It's nearer you than it is me.
Wow. Yeah.
And I don't know if that's coming through the microphone, actually. That's really loud in my ears. Wow. Okay.
Wow. Yeah. So
and on that bombshell.
Next week, then. Yeah. What have we got coming up next week?
So next week, we have John Harding speaking the final installment. Well, I say it's the final installment. What we're going to do is have the final installment with Mr. John Harding next week. But then for a few weeks after that, up until Father's Day, we're going to cover the stories, so one or two of the stories in Mark, which we've not already covered, if that makes sense. Because when we started doing Mark in the live streams, we were like at chapter 6 or 7 or something, because we'd done all the other stuff when we met up as a church. So we're going to take one or two of those stories from Mark. So this is, in fact, John's talk is the last bit of Mark's gospel before we go back and pick out one or two things from the early part of the gospel. And then that's it. We're done with Mark's gospel.
That's right. And then we're going to move on to something new.
Something new and something wonderful, no doubt.
Yes, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. Watch this space.
Watch this space, as they say. No, we've got a whole bunch of great stuff coming up over the summer. You're definitely going to want to connect with us and stay in touch. So make sure you do like or follow on social media, wherever you're watching this broadcast. And if you're so inclined, head on over to our website, crowd.church. And there you can just put in your name and email address, and we will email you once a week to let you know what is coming up in the live stream. Yes, we will. So you can do that. Anything else from you, Sal?
No, that's it. Just to say, I hope everyone has a brilliant week. I won't be with you next week. We are at last able to go and visit some family down south in the south of England. So really looking forward to being able to do that. So I'll leave you in Matt's capable hands for next week.
Capable.
Or I'll just leave you with Matt.
Actually, Rachel's with me next week, so you're all right.
Oh, you'll be okay.
It'll be fine. She'll keep me in order. It's been great to see you. We are going to close out the service with some more worship. Feel free to stick around, enjoy the worship, sing along with it if you want to. But make sure you're back here next week at 4 p.m. as we live stream again. It's been great to chat to you, Sal. Great having you back.
It's been brilliant, Matt. Oh, thank you. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for all your comments and for getting involved. Have a brilliant week and see you soon.
Indeed, we shall. Bless you. Have a great week. Bye for now.
Bye.
I was an orphan lost at the fall, running away when I'd hear Father, you worked your will. I had no righteousness of my own. I had no right to draw near your throne. But Father, you loved me still. And in love before you laid the world's foundation, you predestined to adopt me as your own. Have raised me up so high above my station. I'm a child of God by grace and grace alone. You left your home to seek out the lost. Terrible cost, but Jesus, your face was set. I worked my fingers down to the bone, nothing I did could ever atone. paid my debt. By your blood I have redemption and salvation. Lord, you died that I might reap what you have sown. And you rose that I might be a new creation. I am born again by grace and grace alone. I was in darkness all of my life. I never knew the day from the night. Spirit, you made me see. I swore I knew the way on my own. Head full of rocks, a heart made of stone. Spirit, you moved in me. At your touch, my sleeping spirit was awakened. On my darkened heart, the light of Christ has shone. Called into a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Heaven citizen by grace and grace alone. Yes, I'll stand in faith by grace and grace alone. I will run this race by grace and grace alone.